Baptist Church, we're glad that you're here for our 8:30 time of worship. If you're a visitor, we're especially glad that you're here today. There's a card in the pew in front of you that says, welcome. We'd love for you to take a few moments to pull that card and go ahead and fill it out. You can put it in our offering plate or give it to one of our ushers. This is just a way for us to get to know you a little bit better and hopefully for you to find out more information about the church. But we are certainly glad that you're visiting, so please do fill that card out at your earliest convenience. I have a few things that I want to announce that are in your proclaimer. The first of which is that today is the deadline for parent-child dedication. This is on Mother's Day, May the 8th. We will be dedicating the little babies, and so we're excited about that. So if you have a child that you would like to dedicate to the Lord, please do sign up by today. And I believe that there is a sign-up sheet for that in the church office, so please do sign up. Today is the deadline for that. The second thing is new members class. So if you are new to Liberty and you want to know more about the church, or you want to join with us as a member, then this Saturday, April 23rd, from 9 until noon, we're going to be having a new member class here at the church, and you can sign up in the church office for that as well. But we are glad. You can also, if you just want to come and learn more about the church, you don't have to like join the church by going to the class. You can just come and learn more about our church, and I guarantee you, you'll want to join after you learn more about all the great things that we're doing here. So the next thing is Spring Fling. That is on May the 1st after the 11 o'clock service. I'll just be honest. The 8:30 service, you are our target audience, okay, for this. Because it is for 55 years old and up, and all of you are invited. If you don't know what Spring Fling is, or maybe you've forgotten, it is a... now you're catching on. Okay, good. I'm proving my point as I'm saying it. But anyways, there is a sign-up sheet. It is basically a luncheon for you where our teenagers serve you lunch, and we have some entertainment. It's just a luncheon. Some people have asked me what it is. Well, do I need to dress up? No. This year, the theme is fun in the sun, so you can dress. Maybe not wear a bathing suit, Mark. It is 55 and up, so... maybe you wear your flowery shirt and your nice beach hat. This is getting out of control.
Choir, settle down.
But if you'd like to, we really do want to have a good time. That's what it's all about, is having a good time. And so please do, before you leave today, head right out these doors towards the office, and there's a big display, and you can sign up for Spring Fling. We would love to have you on May 1st after the 11 o'clock service. The last one, as if these announcements have already not gone far enough, I have one more announcement, but you have to hold on. I need to do something before I can do that. Okay. Okay, so I'm wearing goggles now, if you can't see me. These are swimming goggles. This the VBS theme for this year is submerged. Do you get it? Okay, go underwater. You need goggles on. Woo! Okay, how early is it? All right, so June 13th through the 17th, and yes, I can still see my notes. June 13th through the 17th, we have VBS, and it is a fun time. It is a fun week. We would love for you to be involved with VBS, and so you can sign up. You can contact Sandra Landry. Raise your hand, Sandra. Or Joanne Goodrich. Raise your hand, Joanne. And they will get you signed on. Ooh, I actually can't see very well. But, and we would love for you to join us for Submerged. It's all, it's a water theme. So that's why I had to wear my goggles today. And I will probably have to wear them again sometime. We are excited about all the things that are going on here at our church and invite you to join as the Lord leads you. Thank you.
Speaking of Submerged.
Well, I can transition from submerged to baptism now quite easily. Well, you know, what a joy it is. This is the second week in a row that we've had someone in the baptistry. You know, people stating that they want to become a Christian, and I think it's a real joy for this church. Today, coming for baptism is Landon May. Well, Landon, have you admitted your sin and trusted Jesus as your Savior?
Yes, sir.
Well, then I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, raised to walk in newness of life in Christ Jesus. And we certainly ask the Lord for many more.
All God's people said together, what a wonderful thing it is to draw near to God after we see something like that in the baptistry, how His Spirit is moving in our church. Let's stand together as we invite Jesus to draw close to us as we worship Him. Thank you.
Well, let's pray. Our Father, we thank you that you are indeed awesome and mighty to save. That, Lord, you reached down into our world and you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, that we might have life eternal, yes, but that we might have life now and it abundantly. Lord, we thank you that we can come into this place and to praise your holy name, that we can shout your praises above all of the problems of life, all of the troubles that we have. And Lord, we know that in this room there are many struggles, many hurts. There are people that this week have gotten news that is devastating, and they're struggling this week. And God, we ask that you would minister to us by your Holy Spirit. There are people who are celebrating this week. And Lord, we thank you. We celebrate with them. God, we ask that whatever stage of life we're in, whether we are in the valley or on the mountaintop, that Lord, you would meet with us and show us who you are. That God, we would feel your Spirit in this place, and that your Spirit would guide us as we leave this place, that we would feel empowered so that we could represent you in a way that is honoring. So God, we ask that in this hour of worship that you would just indeed meet with us by your Spirit, that we would praise Jesus, and that it would truly transform us from the inside out. Lord, we love you. We thank you. We ask that you'd be with us now in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
is the living water of life. He's also the living spirit of the church, and his desire for is that spirit to revive us as a church. A great hymn of the church says, hallelujah, thine the glory, hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory, revive us. Again, let's stand together as we sing about the Spirit's life in our church.
Heavenly Father, we just come to you today praising your name, Father. May all the glory be to you. Father, we thank you for your love for us and for all that you continue to bless us with. We thank you for the blessing of this beautiful weekend. And Father, I pray for our church. I pray, Father, for those that continue to lead our church. I pray for the ministries here. I pray for our members, those that are struggling, Father, and I lift them up to you at this time. And Father, again, I just thank you for all the blessings that you've given our church. And I just pray now as we have a part in our service where we can give back to you a small portion of what you blessed us with. I pray, Father, that it will be used again to your glory. And Father, keep us mindful of the needs of others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Commanding King of Kings.
It was the only time I ever saw him run. Was when he ran to me, he took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, said, "My son's come home again," lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes, with forgiveness in his voice, he said, "Son, do you know I still love you?" He caught me by surprise, and he brought me to my knees when God died. I saw run to me. I was so ashamed, all alone, and so far away. But now I know that he's been waiting.
I usually don't say anything about this, but I think Mark looks very good today. And if you know me, I almost went home and changed. So let the jokes begin. I'm just going to get ahead of them. You know, some of us are better at communication than others. You know, some of us naturally can get into a room, read people's emotions, read people's faces, understand a person's situation, and then say the right thing. I've also talked to people who rooms frighten them, people's cues are hard to pick up, and communication all the way around is difficult. You know, the idea of communication is only multiplied when we think about communication with God. I mean, think about your communication with God. Usually it happens in the place of prayer or in the place of Bible study or in the place of meditation. But let's just think about the basic questions. The basic questions such as, how do you communicate to God? Or how does God communicate to us? How does God speak to us? The Bible says that God has spoken at many times and in many ways. And yet in these days, he's spoken to us through Jesus. But God certainly does speak to us, I would say even now, through conversations, through circumstances, hopefully through sermons, hopefully in prayer, hopefully through just an impression that God lays on our hearts. You know, when we think about communication with God, it's something to think about. Because God, while he has given us his word, the Spirit of God, I would propose, communicates to us in things that are more real than words. He communicates his presence. He communicates assurance. He communicates the wonder of who God is. You know, the idea is God is a lot bigger than we are. If you don't know that, that'd be a good thing to take away from church today, is that God is a lot bigger than we are, and thus his communication to us is different than our communication to one another, in the sense that he has far more to say than we could hear. And so God just gives us that which we need as we need it. Now, I want to put some of these pieces together just to give you a broad overview of how God communicates from his mind to our heart. Now, I'm going to give you some key words. You may take notes during the sermon. This would be a good time to take notes because you won't remember it unless you take a note. But this just kind of gives you some practical steps along the way to think about how God's thoughts get into our heart. I'm going to give you some big words. They're not really big, but they give some. They all rhyme, so you'll track with them this way. Here's the thing. The only way that we know God is if God reveals himself to us. This is what we call revelation. I'll put up a chart right now. There it is. So let's start with God at the top, all right? And the only way we know God is if God reveals himself to us, revelation. The Bible says that God has revealed himself to different people, and as different people throughout the Bible have heard God, they have been inspired. That's what we talk about. The Bible is the inspired word of God. It means these people actually didn't hear their own words, but they heard the words of God, and thus they wrote them down for us, which we find in the Bible. So you have revelation, then you have inspiration, then what these people who heard God wrote them down, and then that has been preserved, preservation. What they wrote has been passed down through time, and then all of these different things are in different languages. The Bible's written in at least three different languages, Hebrew, Aramaic, and Greek. So unless you can read those, you're lost. So you get a translation. Thus the Bible is translated, and that brings you to this moment where you have the Bible in front of you, and then you read it and interpret it. That's interpretation. But we want to focus today on not only seeing what's there, but the Bible says that as we read what God has spoken, that we need Holy Spirit illumination. We need to know what that text, this word that was given some time ago, how that word is made alive in this moment, illumination. And then once we know what this means for us in this moment, we are driven forward to application. So there it is. I mean, here are some major steps to just begin to get your head around the nature of God's communication to us. And by the way, these are important to just understand God's communication strategy. God has chosen to communicate through his word. He's chosen to communicate through his son. He's chosen to communicate through his spirit. He has a plan. And if we're going to pick up on his cues, if we're going to understand his ways, we've got to know how he speaks. Now, today our text is 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 6 through 16. If you got your Bible, you can go there. But today, the Apostle Paul addresses a real-life church situation in Corinth in which they are profoundly confused. The church at Corinth, if you know anything about the book of 1 Corinthians or 2 Corinthians, they're a confused bunch. And Paul has to correct them almost at every turn. And they are confused about the nature of how God speaks. Quite frankly, they're getting it exactly wrong. And Paul has to turn them in a far better direction. We're talking about the role of the Holy Spirit in our life. And so what we see here is how the Holy Spirit communicates
to us. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 6 through 16. The first point today is this. The Holy Spirit applies God's word in my life because He, the Holy Spirit, fully knows God's ways. Now, just stick with me. I will tell you that our text today is not the easiest to understand on the first time through, but I'm going to work really hard to make it plain. Verse 6 says, however, among the mature we do speak a wisdom, but not a wisdom of this age or the rulers of this age who are coming to nothing. On the contrary, we speak God's hidden wisdom in a mystery, which God predestined before the ages for our glory. None of the rulers of this age knew it, for if they had known it, they would have not crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, what no eye has seen and no ear has heard, and what has never come into a man's heart, is what God has prepared for those who love Him. Now God has revealed them to us by the Spirit, for the Spirit searches everything, even the deep things of God. Now Paul will focus on two types of wisdom right out of the gate. He focuses on a wisdom that is commonly possessed, and he contrasts that, if you just listen to what I said, with another type of wisdom, for God has revealed them to us by His Spirit. Another type of wisdom that comes from God. Now, I'm just going to be honest with you. If this was 1 Corinthians 2, 6 through 16, was your devotional reading for the moment, for the morning, and you had no access to a teacher, you probably would read it and go, well, wasn't that nice, and pray. You'd be lost, I believe. For the most part, you'd have a hard time figuring out what Paul is saying. Part of the reason that that is the case, by the way, Paul's going to make some really very important points. God, through Paul, is going to make some really important points. Here's the problem. The Corinthians are having a tough time, and sometimes when you read the letters of the New Testament, you only get to hear one side of the conversation. It's like listening to someone talking on a phone, right? You hear what they say, but you don't hear what is said to them. You understand this? So you can almost begin to pick up what might be said on the other end, but you don't know. Paul is referencing a problem in the church at Corinth, and here's the problem. As best we can understand it, but we're really confident because of the rest of the letter. This is the problem. The Corinthians are basically in a culture, in a time, where they're thoroughly convinced that in their own wisdom, in their own pursuit of knowledge, in their own acquiring things of God, that they can know God on their own terms. And quite frankly, the church at Corinth really shows how immature they are, because they actually begin to, within the church, say this person has more spiritual knowledge than, say, someone else. And so they begin to faction up. And they even pick the teachers that they like the most. They're a mess, according to the Apostle Paul, a real mess. And so this is, Paul begins, and he looks at this problem in which the church is going the exactly wrong direction at knowing how God communicates. That's what they're doing, and Paul's going to contrast one way of getting wisdom versus another. And this is Paul's point. I'll give it to you in a real simple way. He says, let's talk about the smartest people around. He addresses the Corinthians. He says, let's talk about the smartest people who were around when Jesus was around. He says, let's talk about the religious leaders. Let's talk about those who had all the degrees. Let's talk about those who are wise as far as the world is concerned. He says, let's talk about those for a minute. He says, if they were so smart and their wisdom could understand what God was doing, he asks one big rhetorical question, then why did they kill Jesus? He says, now how smart is that? You understand? If they could understand what God is doing, if they had an inside scoop on the ways of God, if their knowledge was going to figure God out. He says, well, how smart was it that when God became flesh and dwelt among us and did his biggest thing, they killed him? He says, it sounds like your way of knowing things has a problem. Quite frankly, Paul then quotes this statement. He says, no eye saw, no ear heard, and it had not come into anyone's heart what God had in store. The cross surprised everybody. That's his point. He said it shocked us all that we are reconciled to God through a crucified God. Who could have thought that? He said, so nobody figured that one out. And he says, if you didn't figure that one out, good luck figuring anything else out unless God speaks. He says, now this is the first. So what Paul has had once done here is he has cut the spiritual elites off at the knees. He says, listen, you did not come to faith in Jesus through your own ability. You came to faith in Jesus because the Spirit of God revealed what he was doing in the person of Jesus with no help of you. That's his point. Now, that's a very correcting kind of word. Quite frankly, I want to quote a verse of Scripture which is immediately following this, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 24. It says right here, and those who are called, both Jew and Greek, it says, Christ is God's power and God's wisdom. It is the person of Jesus that embodies what God is doing. Now, stick with me, because I'm going to land the plane, but I got to set up what Paul's talking about. Now, this is a very important first point here. To know God, the first step we must know is that we cannot know him lest he reveal himself to us. That's a very important point. To know God, the first thing we must know is that we cannot know him lest he reveal himself to us. Also, the point is, he has revealed himself. Will we see what he has revealed? Now, Paul keeps going, and he gives to the second point. His second major argument, I will land the plane today, and you will know where we're going. The second point is, the Holy Spirit applies God's word in my life because he fully understands who we are. It says, for who among men knows the concerns of a man except the spirit of the man that is in him? And in the same way, no one knows the concerns of God except the Spirit of God. Now, we have not received the Spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God, in order to know what has been freely given to us by God. We also speak these things, not in words taught by human wisdom, but those taught by the Spirit, explaining spiritual things to spiritual people. Now, Paul picks up on this idea of revelation. He's going to talk about us, and then he's going to talk about God. Now, here's something interesting. I mean, look at you guys. I mean, I wish you could see what I see some Sunday mornings. It's a wonderful experience. But Paul, let me make the point that Paul's making. He says, you know, here's the deal. It's really frightening some days. So some days I just pick a spot on the back wall and on that back wall, and I don't look at any of you. I'm just telling you. It's a public speaking trick, and so you got to have a few of those up your sleeves, especially on bad Sundays, okay? Because here's the problem. I have absolutely no idea, truly, what you're thinking. I could potentially infer what you're thinking by looking at your face, but some of you can sleep with your eyes open. I mean, you really can. And I know, and I mean, I can almost count down some of you. Like, he's gone. And I almost know it's about, I mean, some of you, I take my cues to wrap it up by the time lights are out. I mean, you guys help me. So I'm taking cues, but here's the deal. I have no idea what you're thinking. I really don't. And Paul says, here's the deal. He says, who knows a man except the spirit of the man that's within him? I mean, right now you could be making grocery lists. You could be thinking about how hard of a week you've had. You could think, boy, I'm tired. You could be doing anything, and you're sitting here looking at me, and I don't have a clue. And Paul says, look, he says, only you know what you're thinking. And he says, in the same way, listen carefully, only God knows what he's thinking. Now, here's the deal. It says, for who among you knows the concerns of a man except the spirit of the man within him? That's his point. And the same way, no one knows the concerns of God except the spirit of God. That's his point. Now, how would I know what you are thinking? I would have to ask you. And then you could speak. And then if you spoke truthfully, you would reveal yourself to me. And Paul says, well, if it works this way on a human level, he says, then it works this way on the divine level. He says, for we have not received the spirit of the world. We're not trying to figure God out by cues. It says, but the Spirit who is from God, in order to know what has been freely given to us. God has revealed himself. What has been freely given to us by God. He says, we also speak things. The message about Jesus. These things are not taught by human wisdom. We did not figure these out on our own. He says, but in those taught by the Spirit, we know the message about Jesus because the Spirit of God told us. You understand? He revealed this to us, explaining spiritual things, things that have been Spirit-given to people who can receive it. That's his point. Now, I hope you understand where we're driving here. Where we're driving is Christian knowing requires profound dependence upon God. You know what? I remember, if you really try to learn a lot, the more you learn, the more, if you're learning, if you're really learning, you realize the more you learn, the more you don't know. I mean, that's the way. If it's going the other direction, then you're not learning much. Quite frankly, you're becoming more ignorant by the moment. Okay? So if you learn, you figure out, boy, I don't know a lot. And quite frankly, the best learner is the person who knows that they still have a lot more to know, are teachable, and have learned a posture of learning. And this is where Paul's going to strike at them. He's going to say, you Corinthians think that you are learning about God and thus have less and less to learn. Understand? He says, the problem is, that proves to me you're not learning from God at all. He says, because if you learn from God, you know that unless he reveals it to you, you don't have a clue. And as he reveals it to you, you're so shocked by what he reveals, a crucified God, that you are then very confident that you need to be even more dependent upon listening to him. You know what concerns me about church folks? They've lost their dependence and teachability by God. I mean, I should be able to walk up to any church person and say, since we didn't figure out the cross, it surprised us as much as anybody else, then we should have a profound sense of saying, God, if you don't reveal yourself and your ways to me, I am lost. The problem with human knowledge is this, knowledge going in the wrong direction, is that human knowledge makes one think, because they know some things, that they now have elevated their status to such a degree. The Bible says that knowledge, this type of knowledge, puffs up. Quite frankly, praise God for human knowledge as far as it goes. It's done a lot of good, but boy, it's doing a lot of bad when we think the little bit we know that now we don't need God anymore. We've got our cars, and we have our houses, and we have our this, and we have our that, and see, we've known this, and we know that, and we know this, and we've gotten this, and now we know enough. We have enough. And God, we don't need you. Boy, when knowing goes in that direction, it shows how profoundly ignorant we have become. We are mortal people who have limited knowledge, who stand at the base of an infinite God, and to come up with the posture of bloating ourselves up over any type of knowledge is exactly the wrong direction. And Paul says, God makes sure that he discloses himself in such a way that shocks us, to keep us right where we need to be. I want to finish this. I'm going to make a final illustration. I hope you're getting this point, because if you want to hear from God, here's the way it is. If you want to hear from God, you've got to ask Him. And then and God speaks when He believes you're humble enough to hear Him. That's it. It's about that simple. You say, well, what can I do to figure Him out? You can't. That's not the way you know Him. God's not a subject to be studied. He is a person to be encountered. And quite frankly, God does not want to reveal Himself to people who think that all they're going to do with the knowledge that He gives them is try to control Him with it. He doesn't appreciate that one bit. Here's the third point. It says the Holy Spirit applies God's Word in my life because He gives us the capacity to know God. Verse 14, it's not here Paul is saying the natural man is ignorant. He just says the natural man wants to know God in a way God doesn't want to be known. That's what he's saying. He says the natural man does not welcome what comes from God's Spirit because of what he's got to do. He's got to say, I don't know God. You know, I'm here to listen. It says, because it's foolishness to him. Listen, if I can't know God on my own terms, then I don't want to know Him at all. You know, the greatest statements from atheists is, why do you not believe God's there? Not enough evidence. Well, there's plenty of evidence, just not the type of evidence they want. God wants them to know it on a different way. It says, he is not able to know since it is evaluated spiritually. Verse 15, this is not a statement of status, but a statement of condition. The spiritual person, the one, however, can evaluate everything. Yet he himself cannot be evaluated by anyone. For who has known the Lord's mind that he may instruct him? Nobody's known the Lord's mind that he may instruct him. You understand? Only God knows his own mind. It says, but if God has revealed his mind to us, then but we have the mind of Christ. We actually know what God is up to in the person of Jesus. Why? Because he has spoken. That's why. It's the only reason. The difference between the natural man and the spiritual man is the natural man thinks he can figure out God in his own terms. And the spiritual man realizes if God doesn't speak, he'll never know. I want to give one final illustration here. It's not my illustration. It's a famous illustration that's been used multiple times. But this begins to show you why. You know, here's the thing. We need a holy book. We need a Holy Spirit to communicate to us. God has to reveal himself to us. Let me give you an illustration. Here's the famous illustration of Aunt Matilda's pie. You ready for it? There she is. I even got a picture. I don't know if she's Aunt Matilda, but there she is, Aunt Matilda's pie. You ready for it? Just listen to it. Just listen to this illustration. So Aunt Matilda brings out this beautiful pie and begins to present this to a group. And the master of ceremonies wants to know some things about Aunt Matilda's pie, and so he puts together a team of the best of human knowing. He wants to understand Aunt Matilda's pie, and so he calls out the nutritional scientist to tell us how many calories in the cake. And the nutritional scientists take the cake and figure out, well, right down to the last calorie, how many calories are in the cake. And then the biochemist, he is able to take the cake and figure out how many of the structure of the proteins. And then the physicist is able to analyze the cake down to its fundamental particles. And even the mathematician is able to come up and to devise an eloquent equation of how all of these particles within the cake behave. And so then the master of ceremonies stands up and says, Now we have exhaustively described the cake. You know what? There's one big question. Certainly we know a lot of how the cake is made, but I want to know one very simple question. Why did Aunt Matilda make the pie? Did you know that there is not one strand of human knowing that can tell us why Aunt Matilda made the pie? The only person who knows why she made the pie is who? Aunt Matilda. And if she doesn't tell us, we'll never know. And she has to speak to tell us the big question that we want to know. Did you know human knowledge can do a lot of things? But you say, why do I believe? Why does Rusty believe in Revelation? Why does he believe? Why do I believe that God must speak? Because all of human knowing cannot even answer the basic questions of a child. Who am I? Where did I come from? Where am I going? Why am I here? There isn't a single person that possesses human knowledge who knows the answer to those questions except the very one who made us. And if he doesn't tell us, we don't know. And the bigger question is, if I am separated from this God, how can I be made right with him? And the Spirit says, because I have sent my Son, I have sent Jesus to die on a cross for the reconciliation of humanity to me. You say, how do I know God? Well, you know God, and he communicates to you once you learn how to know him. You know, only to know God, this is the truth, he must reveal himself to us. And the Bible says that he does so by means of the Holy Spirit of God. If you're here today, you say, well, I'm here. This is my first Sunday here, my second Sunday here, my third Sunday here. What does God want to reveal? Well, I would say first and foremost, he wants to reveal his Son to you, Jesus. The Holy Spirit's role, by the way, is to shine the spotlight on Jesus, to let people know who he is. And he wants you to know that even though you are separated from him, you can be reconciled to him through faith in him. He wants you to know that. The second thing I would say, if that's for you, are Christians. By the way, if you're not a Christian and you've never trusted in Jesus, I'll be right down here at the front. I'll take the Bible. I'll show you how you can be a Christian. But what about us Christians? I want to give two other passages of Scripture because Paul's given us a lot of the back work. But I want to just give you two other Scriptures that kind of encapsulate what this is all about. Proverbs chapter 1, verse 7. The book of Proverbs is agreeing wholeheartedly here with Paul that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. You want to know where to start? Know that if God doesn't reveal to you the big stuff, you're lost. It says, but fools despise wisdom and instructions. James chapter 1, verse 5. James says this, if any of you lack wisdom, he says, you should go try to figure God out on your own. Is that what he says? And he should ask God. That's the place to start. God may lead you beyond that, but that's the place to start. He must ask God, who gives to all generously without criticizing. Isn't it nice to know when you tell God you don't know that he doesn't criticize you for your ignorance, but generously gives what you need? He says, and it will be given to him. But he gives some stipulations. But let him ask in faith without doubting, for the doubter is like a surging sea driven and tossed by the wind. That person should not expect to receive anything from the Lord. An indecisive man is unstable in all of his ways. Here is some final words. Practical direction. The things that you need to know. So some of you, you're not a Christian. You need to know what God has done in Jesus. But for those of you who are Christians, remember the whole illumination bit? How does this apply to me? Did you know that there is nowhere in the Bible that gives you the answer to how to apply what the Scripture says to your heart? You know, you got to be dependent upon the Spirit of God. You got to say, God, I hear what your word says. It's a lamp unto my feet. It's a light unto my path. But now, Holy Spirit of God, would you just reveal to me practical direction in my life? Would you tell me how to interact with such and such? Would you tell me, should I take this opportunity? Would you tell me how I should be comforted in this tough moment? God, could you help me understand why this spiritual dryness at this moment? God, could you help me understand this? And you at that moment, to get direction from the mind of God to your heart, are fully dependent upon Him. And here's the good news, that if you'll just say, God, I don't know. James says, if any man lack wisdom, we have a God who has revealed Himself. He is not silent. He wants to be known by those who want to know Him. The question today is not, can God be known? That's not the question. The question is, do you want to know Him in the way He wants to be known? God wants to open His heart to you, but He wants you to, the first thing you need to know is that He's God. And that to hear from Him, He wants you to come to Him and just say, God, I don't know, can you help me? Can you reveal yourself to me? Thank you for the cross. I didn't see that one coming. So there's probably some other things I don't see coming too. And so here I am. And I would say at this moment, whether it's through deep conviction, whether it's through encouragement, whether it's through another person, whether it's through a situation, you will know that God has spoken in a very decisive way. Question is, He's speaking. Are you listening? Are you open to the Holy Spirit's voice as He applies direction, God's word, in your life? You hear and you're not a Christian, the altar will be open. If you are a Christian and you don't know what to do, why not use this altar and just say, God, show me, help me. You want to reveal yourself to me? I'm here to listen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you today. God, may we not be confused on this very fundamental truth that you desire to reveal yourself to us. But God, you want us to realize that if you are going to reveal yourself to us, that we have to cast aside our wrong thinking, that we think we can know you on our own terms and in our own ways. And so right here in the place of true openness, true humility, God, we ask for your guidance. We pray right now that the words that I have spoken would fade away. And that God, in this place, in the hearts of people, as Paul said, he didn't speak with great swelling words, so that people's faith would not rest on men's wisdom, but on your power. And so, Holy Spirit of God, would you take whatever feeble attempt has been to communicate your word, and now may you, by your Spirit, in the hearts individually of each person, may you now apply it in the most real of ways. And God, as people hear your voice and not mine, I pray that they would be moved to whatever action appropriate. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand again.
Precious cornerstone, sure foundation, you are faithful to the end. We are waiting on you, Jesus. We cornerstone, sure foundation, you are faithful.
Father, as we stand here in this moment and think about all that is yet to be revealed to us. God, you tell us that you will raise our bodies. God, you tell us that you will make a world where there is no more death and no more crying and no more pain and no more grief. God, as we gaze into eternity and think about all that is yet to come, all that is yet to be revealed, indeed no eye has seen it, no ear has heard it, and no heart has even yet to begin to fully grasp it. So God, when we think about how infinite you are and how much there is to still know, to still experience, to still be revealed, then God, rid us in this moment of not saying, Holy Spirit, speak. Holy Spirit, reveal. Show me, teach me, direct me, comfort me, encourage me. And so, God, we thank you that we can call to you and you can show us great and mighty things that we do not know. May we leave from this place humbled, casting aside self-sufficiency, and dependent upon you in an even more intimate way. In Jesus' name.